الحمد لله كفى والصلاة والسلام على النبي المصطفى المجتبى وبعد. My dear respective brothers and sisters, as announced inshallah ta'ala, in this sitting we want to go through a concise description of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and also maybe some of his characteristics, his etiquettes, the way the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam conducted him with others. But before I do, my brothers and sisters, I want to maybe speak about an individual called Alan Shearer. I don't think anybody here is unknowing of who Alan Shearer is. They used to call him Fox in the Box, one of the best players to ever play for Newcastle. The reason why I want to speak about Alan Shearer, my brothers and sisters, because there used to be a kid in Newcastle. And this was one of the mashayikh telling me this. This kid, my brothers and sisters, he was Alan Shearer crazy. He would wake up Alan Shearer, he would go to sleep Alan Shearer. He would leave the house speaking about Alan Shearer, he would go back into his house speaking about Alan Shearer. There was pictures on his wall, all of Alan Shearer, his duvet had Alan Shearer on there and his cushion had Alan Shearer on there. He was like the Messi and the Ronaldo and the Neymar of this time. The reason why I mention this, my brothers and sisters, this kid became very, very ill. This kid became very ill and he was on his deathbed. I'm sure we've heard of the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ كَانَ آخِرُ كَلَامِهِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever's last statement is لا إله إلا الله, this individual will enter into a Jannah. If every single one of us here today was asked to utter the shahada, the kalima, we would be able to do so without any difficulty, any problem whatsoever. But my brothers and sisters, it's not as simple as that on our deathbed. Because the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَنَّ مَنْ عَاشَ عَلَى شَيْءٍ مَاتَ عَلَيْهِ وَمَنْ مَاتَ عَلَيْهِ بُعِثَ عَلَيْهِ, as Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala said. It is very well known that if a person, he lives a certain way, he's most likely to die that very way. And whoever dies a certain way, he's going to be resurrected on Yawm al-Qiyamah that way that he died. So this individual, my brother says that was Alan Shearer crazy, you can imagine. They asked him to read the kalima on his deathbed. The sheikh came to the house, tried to do the talqeen, make him utter this kalima. What do you think, my brothers and sisters, he mentioned? Or how he died? He died saying, Alan Shearer, Alan Shearer. My mother one time, she told me a story about a family that she knew, a sister. And she was in a haram relationship with another guy. This guy, he ended up being afflicted with HIV. So he was on his deathbed. It was somebody who used to commit zina on a regular basis with this girl. On his deathbed, the sheikh turns up, tries to make him say, La ilaha illallah. What do you think he said, my brothers and sisters? He died saying the name of his girlfriend. Every Eid we hear about a casualty of somebody who may have passed away, or the Malakul Maut ripped his soul out of his chest when he was maybe involved or indulging in haram. وَمَنْ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ شَيْءٍ وَمَنْ عَاشَ عَلَى شَيْءٍ مَاتَ عَلَيْهِ. Whoever lives a certain life, he's most likely to die a certain way. The reason why I mention these stories, my brothers and sisters, how many of us today can say that we live the life of this kid who died saying Alan Shearer about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That we wake up thinking about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We go to sleep thinking about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us from those who accompany the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rabi'at ibn Ka'b al-Aslami, the great companion, was one time with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, Sal, ask. He said to him, As'aluka murafaqataka fil jannah. Look at the first thing that he asked for. I ask to be from those who accompany you in the Jannah. So he said to him, is there anything else you want? وَهَلْ فِي غَيْرِ ذَلِكَ شَيْءٍ. He goes, لا, that's all I want. He then responded back and he said to him, فَأَعِنِّي عَلَى ذِكْرِكَ بكثرة السجود. فعني على نفسك بكثرة السجود. If you want to be from those who accompany me on يوم القيامة, be from those who have a lot of sujood, a lot of prostrations. Point of the matter is, my brothers and sisters, every single one of us want to be with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We claim to love Allah Azza wa Jalla and His Messenger, and rightfully so. Anybody who is asked, he will claim that he loves Allah Azza wa Jalla and His Messenger. And a person's iman cannot be complete except by doing so, right? But how many of us, my brothers and sisters, actually live that life of true love of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? When we wake up thinking about him, when we go to sleep, we implement his sunnah one by one. We go through the books of hadith, wanting to live our life with every step that we take, every move that we make, it's in accordance to how the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lived his life. That's all we are living for, my brothers and sisters, breathing in this dunya. We want to be from those who accompany the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My brothers and sisters, I can sit here holding a banner claiming that I truly love the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But everybody can make a da'wah, can make a claim. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala called a specific ayah in the Quran in Surah Ali Imran, Ayatul Mihna, the verse of examination. And that very ayah is, my brothers and sisters, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونَ يُحْبِدْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Say to them, O Muhammad, if they truly love Allah Azza wa Jal, then let them follow me. يُحْبِبْكُمْ اللَّهِ and Allah Azza wa Jal will love you. Hassan al-Basri, the great tabi'i, the great tabi'i, my brothers and sisters, commented on this verse and he said, زَعَمُوا أَنَّهُمْ يُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. People claimed that they love Allah Azza wa Jal and His Messenger. فَابْتَلَاهُمُ اللَّهُ بِهَذِهِ الْآيَةِ. He trialed them with this verse. Like I said, I can say it with a banner. I can put posters all over my house saying that I love Allah Azza wa Jal. And I can do as many innovations as I want saying that I'm doing this because I love Allah Azza wa Jal, His Messenger. But that which really truly counts is that which the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with and how he done every action when he lived on the face of this earth. May Allah Azza wa Jal make us from those who love Allah Azza wa Jal and His Messenger truly. And we can only do that, my brothers and sisters, by studying His way. Hence why I have decided to maybe go through this topic. Or it was actually the choice of the masjid. Many other places I've decided to speak about Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's etiquettes, his mannerism, which we will be inshallah ta'ala touching on at the end. After we've spoken about the description of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Allah Azza wa Jalla told us about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you are one that has lofty characteristics and mannerism. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was asked, how was the etiquette of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? She responded back and she said, كَانَ خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ. His etiquette was the Qur'an. These are hadith, my brothers and sisters, that I will be going through. I have taken it out of the kitab of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala called Al-Jawab al-Sahih لِمَنْ بَدَّلَ دِينَ الْمَسِيحِ. The correct answer for the one who changed the religion of Al-Masih. He has a fasal, a chapter in there, which talks about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his description, his characteristic. Sometimes one of the ways to encourage or convince a non-Muslim when we're giving da'wah to him, because everybody has this barbaric image that he was a bloodthirsty individual. That in fact, if we went out to the kuffar, the non-Muslims, and gave da'wah to them, explaining to them how such a wonderful, kind, generous individual he was, maybe this kind of image wouldn't be there. Bara ibn Azib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, speaking about the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's noble face, he said, كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam أَحْسَنَ النَّاسِ وَجْهَا. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was from those who had the most beautiful of faces. وَأَحْسَنُهُمْ خَلْقًا. And his appearance was so beautifully structured. ليس بالطويل الذاهب ولا بالقصير. The messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم wasn't too tall nor was he too short. His height was an average one. وعنه رضي الله تعالى عنه also براء بن عازب said كان بعيد ما بين المنكبين. The messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم had a broad chest. عظيم الجمة إلى شحمة أذنيه. He had thick hair coming down to his shoulders. عليه حلة حمراء. He was wearing some red garments. And then he said, ما رأيت شيئا قط أحسن من. I never saw anything that was more beautiful than the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. My brothers and sisters, if we just ponder upon this last statement of Bara ibn Azib, he did not say, I did not see any individual or any human being that was more beautiful or more handsome than the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, I did not see anything that was more beautiful than the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that involves or consists of all of the creation, whether it is the star, whether it is the moon, whether it is the sun. When you look at the lovely great scenery that we have in this dunya, nothing looked better than the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in usul al-fiqh, and likewise in nahw, there's a principle which states, as Imam al-Sa'di rahimahullah ta'ala in his Qawa'id al-Fiqhiyya says, وَالنَّكِرَاتُ فِي سِيَاقِ النَّفْيِ تُعْتِ الْعُمُومَ أَوْ سِيَاقِ النَّهِي تُعْتِ الْعُمُومَ أَوْ سِيَاقِ النَّهِي. If an indefinite comes now in a negative context, it indicates generality. So here you have an indefinite which is shay'an, nothing, here in a negative context, which means that nothing was more beautiful than the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. A question may have popped up in our minds. It's a common question that tends to be asked as well. Here the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam was wearing red. Is it haram? Is it a problem to be wearing red? Is it the color of Iblis, as some may think? Because there's another narration, my brothers and sisters, which states, it's Ibn Bara ibn Azib himself narrating it, نهانا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن المياثر. The messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم prohibited us from wearing red clothing. And the intended purpose is, my brothers and sisters, الأحمر الخالص. If somebody is wearing red, is wearing a garment that is purely red. By the way, this is burgundy, it's not red. So here the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was speaking about a pure red. But if that red garment was mixed with another color, or it had black stripes, or it had white stripes, then this is not what the prohibition is consisting of. Also, Bara ibn Azib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was asked, أَكَانَ وَجْهُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمِ مِثْلَ السَّيْفِ. Was the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's face as bright as a sword? قَالَ لَا بَلْ مِثْلَ الْقَمَرِ. He said, no, but it was as bright as the moon. In another narration, Ka'b ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, كَانَ النَّبِيُّ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam إِذَا سُرَّ اسْتَنَارَ وَجْهُ حَتَّى كَأَنَّهُ فِلْقَةُ قَمَرِ. Whenever the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam was made happy, his face would glitter as if it was a piece of the moon. Again, the description of the face of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ali ibn Abi Talib, he talked to us again about the face of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He told us, لم يكن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بالمطهم ولا المكلثم وكان في وجهه تدوير. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's face wasn't al-mutahham, which means al-muntafikh. His face wasn't bulky. While at the same time, you could see that his face wasn't a heavy type of face. And then he said, وَكَانَ فِي وَجْهِ تَدْوِيرِ. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's face, my brothers and sisters, had a roundish face. It wasn't round, but it had a roundish texture to it. It was narrated by Imam Muslim rahimahullah ta'ala min hadith Jabir ibn Samurah radi anna rajulan qal, that a man, he asked, akana wajhu rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mithla sayf. Was the face of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the shape of a sword. I'm sure we know how the sword looks like. He said, لا مثل الشمس والقمر مستديرا. But rather his face was the shape of a sun, or maybe the shape of the moon. Again, it was roundish, but it wasn't too round. Muhammad ibn Yasar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he one time said, قلتُ, I said to Rubayya bint Mu'awad ibn Afra, صِفِي لِي رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Describe to me the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. She responded back and she said, يَا بُنَيَّ لَوْ رَأَيْتَهُ رَأَيْتَ الشَّمْسَ طَالِعًا. O son, if you was to see the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was more illuminant than the sun. He was more illuminant than the sun. One time, my brothers and sisters, Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he came out of his home. And it was on a night where the moon was shining at its brightest, on the 14th night of the month. This is when, my brothers and sisters, the moon is shining at its brightest. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he looked at the moon and then he looked at the sun. He looked at the moon and then he looked at the sun. He looked at the moon and he looked at the sun. And then he said, when I looked at the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's face, it was more brighter, more shinier than the moon that came out on this night on the 14th of the month. In another narration, my brothers and sisters, Abdullah ibn al-Harith radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, أَنَّ تِلْكَ الْبَشَاشَ فِي وُجُوهِ النَّاسِ. That glow on the faces of the companions, كَانَتْ هَدْيًا مُسْتَمِرًا لِلْمُصْطَفَى. This was a continuous guidance of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَيَقُولَ, and he said, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا أَكْثَرَ تَبَسُّمًا مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم. I never saw anybody who smiled more than the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he spoke to us about some of the features, the body parts of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ دَخْمَ الرَّأْسِ وَالْقَدَمَيْنِ. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had a big head and he also had big hands. لَمْ أَرَى قَبْلَهُ وَلَا بَعْدَهُ مِثْلَهُ. I didn't see anyone who looked better than the Messenger sallallahu, or anything that looked like the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before I knew him and after the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. وَكَانَ بَسِطَ الْكَفَّيْنِ دَخْمَ الْيَدَّيْنِ. The hands of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were smooth and his hands were quite big as well. وَسُئِلَ عَنْ شَعْرِ, he was asked about his hair. He said, كَانَ شَعِرًا رَجِلًا لَيْسَ بِالْجَعْدِ وَلَا بِالْسَبْتِ بَيْنَ أُذُنَيْهِ وَعَاتِقِهِ. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's hair wasn't curly, nor was it straight, but rather it was a type that was in between. You might want to call it wavy. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's hair was wavy. Wasn't too curly, while at the same time it wasn't too straight. It was in between. Also, some of the scholars, when they explained دَخْمَ الرَّأْسِ, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a large head, they explained it to be a very intelligent mind. And this is also a description that is befitting for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his hair, as we mentioned earlier also in another narration, was hanging over his shoulders. This narration states it was between his earlobes and also his shoulders. Of course, there is no contradiction, and we know that a person who goes through different marahil on a yearly basis, where sometimes his hair is long and sometimes his hair is short. So sometimes you would find that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would allow his hair to grow even longer. In another narration, Jabir ibn Samurah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ ظَلِيعَ الْفَمْ أَشْكَلَ الْعَيْنَيْنِ مَنْهُوسَ الْعَقِبَيْنِ. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم's mouth was quite wide. أَشْكَلَ الْعَيْنِ. Some of the scholars, they explain this to be as his eyes being quite big. All the place or the area where the eye fits in was quite wide. But this was an explanation or a tafsir that was rejected by some of the scholars. But what they mentioned with regards to this part of when Jabir ibn Samurah, he describes to us these features, كان أشكل العينين أي عينه في بياضها حمرة يسيرة وهذا يعطي العين جمالا وحسنا. Around the pupil we find, my brothers and sisters, in the eye, the black part, there is a white area, ليس كذلك. This had a texture of red to it. And this only, my brothers and sisters, increases the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in beauty. منهوش العقبين. His heels, they were not fleshy. His heels were not fleshy. In another narration, my brothers and sisters, even though some of these we've already mentioned, but there's other description of the face of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس بالطويل البائن ولا بالقصير. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم wasn't too tall, while at the same time he wasn't too short. He was an average height. وليس بالأبيض الأمهق ولا بالآدم ولا بالجعد القطط ولا بالسبط. وليس بالأبيض الأمهق, which means شديد البياض. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم wasn't too white. His skin texture wasn't too white, or as you might want to call it, purely white. وَلَا بِالْآدَمِ, while at the same time it wasn't a brown color, but rather it was wasat, in between. In another narration, it states that Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, كَانَ أَزْهَرُ اللَّوْنِ. أَزْهَرُ اللَّوْنِ, maybe the best way to interpret that is, it had a beautiful mixture of white and red in his skin complexion. And all of this, my brothers and sisters, it just increases the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in being more handsome. Some narrations state it had a brownish touch to it, while some others they say it was a beautiful mixture of white and red when you look at the skin complexion of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as we already mentioned, وَلَا بِالْجَعْدِ الْقَطِطِ, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hair wasn't curly, while at the same time he didn't have hair that was straightened, but it was in between. In another narration, we are told, my brothers and sisters, by Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ أَزْهَرُ اللَّوْنِ, and we've already explained this, كَأَنَّ عَرَقَهُ اللُّؤْلُؤُ, the sweat of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would shine like pearls. إِذَا مَشَى تَكَفَّأَ, he would walk in a humble way. He would walk in a calm and humble way. And the scholars, they mention another explanation for it, which I will come on to inshallah ta'ala, when I speak about the walk of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِذَا مَشَى تَكَفَّأَ وَمَا مَسَسْتُ دِيبَاجَةً وَلَا حَرِيرًا أَلْيَنَ مِنْ كَفِّ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I never touched silk. Two types of silk were mentioned. Dibaja and also harir. The difference between the two is that the dibaj is a thick type of silk, and the harir is just a, you know, a normal type of silk. You might want to call it a thinner type. So he said, I never touched any silk that was more softer min kafi rasulillah, the hands of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلَا شَمَمْتُ مِسْكًا وَلَا عَبَرَةً أَطْيَبَ مِنْ رَاحَةَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I never smelt a fragrance or a musk. And ambar is a type of fragrance they had in the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's time, that smelt better than the smell of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In another narration that speaks about the sweat of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and how the companions used to behave towards his sweat, Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, دخل علينا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال عندنا. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم one time entered upon us and he had a afternoon nap. You might want to call it a siesta or a power nap. This is something that the Arabs, they do on a regular basis, especially in the Arab world because of the heat. They have a nap in the afternoon, maybe before dhuhr or maybe after dhuhr. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a qaylula, a siesta. فعرق. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started sweating. وجاءت أمي بقارورة. So Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, he says that my mom, she came with a bottle. فجعلت تسلت عرقه. So she began to take the bottle and use it to take the sweat of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She tried to enter into the bottle. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam woke up. Why she was doing this? So he asked her, Ya Umm Sulaym, ma hadha alladhi tasna'in? Oh Umm Sulaym, what is this that you are doing? قالت تسلت العرق فيها هذه قارورة أسلت العرق فيها. This is a bottle which I'm using to take your sweat. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was quite surprised, right? And you can imagine. So she said, هذا عرقك نجعله في طيبنا. This is your sweat that we use for our fragrance. وهو أطيب من الطيب الذي عندنا. And it smells better than the fragrances that we have. And it was also mentioned by Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, narrated by Ad-Darimi, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يسلك طريقا فيتبعه أحد إلا عرف أنه قد سلك من طيب عرقه. Never did the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم ever take a path. And whenever the companions, they took that path, they would know that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went this direction because of the smell, the great fragrance that you would still be able to smell after the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has walked past. So the walk of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كان رسول الله إذا مشى تكفى تكفواً وكان أسرع الناس مشية وأحسنها. Whenever the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam walked, he would walk in a tranquil, calm way. وكان أحسنهم خلقا. And he had the best of manners. In another narration, we are told that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's walk was a very quick one. Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, ما رأيت أحدا أسرع في مشيته من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. I didn't see anybody who was ever as quick as the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم in his walk. كأنما الأرض تطوى له. It's as if the earth was being folded for him. وإنا لنجهد أنفسنا وإنه لغير مكترث. We would be exerting our efforts, trying our utmost best in order to keep up with him, but we wouldn't be able to do so. While the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wouldn't be feeling any difficulty whatsoever while he was walking. In another narration, my brothers and sisters, we are told, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا مشى تكفى تكفوا وكان أسرع الناس مشى. Whenever he walked, it's as if the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was descending from a mountain. Some of you may have seen a certain individual, when he walks, he takes very large steps like that. Difference between taking small steps is that a person, he walks like this, right? This person, when a person comes down from a mountain, he takes very lengthy steps. So the narrator states that it's as if he was coming down from a mountain. And normally when you come down, you would take very long steps. He would walk on the face of this earth in such a way. One time, Umm Ma'badin radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was asked by her husband to describe the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She said, رَأَيْتُ رَجُلًا ظَاهِرَ الْوَضَاءَ حِلْوَ الْمَنْطِقِ. I saw an individual who was glowing. حِلْوَ الْمَنْطِقِ, somebody who was very well spoken. فَصْلٌ لَا نَزْرٌ وَلَا هَذَرٌ كأن منطقه خزرات نظم يتحدرنا. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was somebody who spoke very, very well. وَسَطٌ فِي الْكَلَامِ وَالْقَوْلُ الْفَصْلِ هُوَ الْكَلَامُ الْقَلِيلُ الَّذِي يَجْمَعُ الْمَعَانِيَ الْكَثِيرُ. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam needed only a few words to get his point across. He wouldn't need to speak so much in order to make the person understand. This is why we know through another hadith that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given the jawami' al-kalim, which means the comprehensive speech. He will speak very little, but that little that he spoke consisted of great, immense meanings. This is why, my brothers and sisters, if you look at a lot of the hadith in Arba'een al-Nawawi, 40 hadith of Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, you find it very, very short. But when you look at, let's just say, for example, the statement of إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ أي لا يُقْبَلُ أَيُّ عَمَلٍ إِلَّا بِالنِّيَاتِ. No action is accepted from a person except with the correct intention. Volumes have been written on it. Just that small amount. And other hadith of Zohar, مَنْ أَحْدَثَ بِأَمْرِنَا هَذَا مَا لَيْسَ مِنْهُ فَهُوَ رَدْ. Whoever innovates anything into our affairs, then this will be مَرْدُودٌ عَلَيْهِ, will be rejected from him. Books and books and books have been written, just discussing the matter of this small statement of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, speaking about innovation. وَهَلُمَّ جَرَّى. And the examples of this are many. كأن منطقه خزرات نظم يتحدرنا. His words would be flowing forth like a perfect string of pearls. In another narration, she states that I saw a man who was really handsome, of glowing countenance and of good proportions. Sometimes you find a person, the way he's structured, his head might be larger than his body, or some of his body parts are much larger than his other body parts. Here the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was of good proportions, with neither a large stomach nor a small head. He had a smart appearance with a balanced look. In another narration, my brothers and sisters, this now more speaks about how the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was as an individual. Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he states, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا أَنْجَدَ وَلَا أَجْوَدَ وَلَا أَشْجَعَ وَلَا أَضْوَى مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. I never saw anybody who was more stronger, more generous, and more brave than the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. Bara ibn Azib, he says, كُنَّا إِذَا حْمَرَّ الْبَأْسُ نَتَّقِي بِهِ. Whenever the matter became severe, we would go and use the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a shield. He would be in the front line. وَإِنَّ الشُّجَاعَ مِنَّ الَّذِي يُحَاذِي بِهِ يَعْنِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. The brave one would be considered amongst the companion as the one who was standing beside the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at a time when their companions were terrified. They would either run behind his back, as for the brave one who would be standing beside his side. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, also speaking about the bravery of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لما كان يوم بدر اتقينا المشركين برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وكان أشد الناس بأسا. On the day of Badr, we feared the mushrikeen, we would use the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a shield. وكان أشد الناس بأسا أي قوة وإقداما وشجاعة. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be the brave heart who would be rushing forth towards the enemy. وما كان أحد أقرب إلى العدو منه. Nobody was more closer to the enemy than the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Narrated by Al-Bayhaqi rahimahullah ta'ala. Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu ta'ala anhu also speaks to us about the bravery of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أحسن الناس. He was the best of the people. وكان أجود الناس. And he was also the most generous of them. وكان أشجع الناس. And he was also the most bravest amongst us. ولقد فزعنا يوما. There was a day when we became terrified. They were in Al-Madinah and they heard a very loud noise. So they became terrified. So he said, فَانْطَلَقَ النَّاسُ قِبَلَ الصَّوْتِ. So the companions, they headed towards the sound that they heard that caused them to become terrified. فَتَلَقَّاهُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ رَاجِعًا. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was already returning back from this sound that caused them to become terrified. وَقَدْ سَبَقَهُمْ إِلَى الصَّوْتِ وَقَدْ إِسْتَبْرَأَ الْخَبَرُ. And he already found out what the issue was. وَهُوَ عَلَى فَرَسٍ لِأَبِي طَلْحَةَ عَلِيٌّ فِي عُنُقِهِ السَّيْفُ وَهُوَ يَقُولُ لَنْ تُرَاعُوا. Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was coming back and he started telling the companions, you've got nothing to worry about. There is no issues whatsoever. Standing over my brothers and sisters, in that hadith that we just took, Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu stated, and also Ibn Umar, وَكَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ أَجْوَدَ النَّاسِ. He was the most generous of them. If we just stand over the state of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, because it will make us, you know, really to come anywhere close to understanding his situation and how he was actually such a generous when his situation was completely of somebody who wouldn't be expected to pay charity. Hadith Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, Sahih Muslim, she said, دخل علينا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات يوم فقال هل عندكم شيء. One day the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم entered into the home and he asked, is there anything that you have in the home so I can eat from it? قلنا لا. So we responded back and we said, no, we don't have anything. ثم أتانا يوما آخر. Then he came on another day. فقلنا أهدي لنا حيس. So we said that we were gifted with a type of food called حيس, which is a very humble type of food that he had in the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, أرينيه فلقد أصبحت صائما. Show me because I woke up in the morning and I fasted. Why? Because the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم had nothing to eat. My brother says, when we're going through these narrations, let us try, imagine the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this state. Imagine we woke up one time and we opened the fridge and there was nothing in there. The way this country has been structured is, it's very difficult for a person to be broke. He loses his job, you have another option, which is job seeker's allowance. You have benefits, you have housing benefits, and so on and so forth, all the child tax, all the stuff that they give an individual. Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best of creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose this for him. He went through many trials and tribulations. He had 7 kids, my brothers and sisters, living with him. As Ibn Abdul Izz al-Hanafi rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, وَوُلْدُهُ مِنْهَا خَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمُ فالأول القاسم حاز التكريم وزينب رقية وفاطمة وأم كلثوم لهن خاتمة والطاهر الطيب عبد الله وقيل كل اسم لفرد زاهي والكل في حياته ذاق الحمام وبعده فاطمة من إسبعام. In these lines of poetry we are told about the names of the children of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. 6 of the 7 children, my brothers and sisters, they all passed away in his lifetime. Can also imagine he's poor. What did he have to feed his kids with? If there would be times where he would walk into the home and there's nothing there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for the best of creation to be in a state. Again, it's a common atheist question to say that if there's really, really a God, why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowing all of these poor people to suffer with hunger and thirst? Here, my brothers and sisters, we are being shown the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had the life. We are not in the dunya here or the dar where we are expected to be rewarded. The reward comes in the akhirah. That is dar al-jaza. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. The one who created life and death in order to trial and tribulate an individual to see who's going to come with the best of the action. الدنيا سجن المؤمن وجنة الكافر. الدنيا سجن المؤمن وجنة الكافر. The dunya is the prison of the believer and the jannah of the kafir. It's not expected, my brothers and sisters, for us to enjoy ourselves. It's a time of ibtila. We go through trials and tribulations and difficulties. Look at the story of Al-Buruj, the boy and the king, in Surah Al-Buruj. The problems and the difficulties they went through, they were thrown in the pits and young children were being burnt. And they desire the Akhirah. In another narration, my brothers and sisters, Juwayriyah Umm al-Mu'mineen رضي الله تعالى عنها, the mother of the believers, she said, مات رسول الله صلى الله, ما ترك رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عند موتي درهما ولا دينارا. When the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم passed away, he didn't leave a dirham nor a dinar. They were the pounds and the dollars and the euros. The time of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, dirham and the dinar. So he didn't leave anything behind. ولا عبدا ولا أمة ولا شيئا. Nor did he leave behind a slave girl nor a slave boy. But rather he left nothing behind. And then she says, إلا بغلته البيضاء, a white mule that he had, وسلاحا, a sword, وأرضا جعلها صدقة, a piece of land that he gave as charity. Why am I mentioning all these narrations? Am I encouraging the congregation to be poor individuals? In another narration, my brothers and sisters, one time the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left his home at a time when normally people are fast asleep. He bumped into Umar and also Abu Bakr radiallahu anhuma. He asked them, مَا أَخْرَجَكُمَا فِي هَذِي سَاعَةً, what caused you to leave your homes at this hour? He said, مَا أَخْرَجَنَا إِلَّا الْجُوعِ, that which caused us to leave was none other than being hungry. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَاللَّهِ مَا أَخْرَجَنِي إِلَّا مَا أَخْرَجَكُمَا, that which caused me to leave my home was none other because of what caused you to leave your homes. All these narrations, my brothers and sisters, what do we learn from it? That he was a poor individual. While at the same time, كَانَ مِنْ أَجْوَدِ النَّاسِ, he was the most generous of them. And in the month of Ramadan, he was even more generous. وَكَانَ أَجْوَدُ مَا يَكُونُ مِنْ رِيحِ الْمُرْسَلَةِ, he would be quicker to give in charity than the breezing wind. It's a kinaya. Another narration, my brothers and sisters, and the time is nearly up as well. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, خدمت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم 10 سنين. I gave service to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم for 10 whole years. ما قال لي أفا قط. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم never ever said أف to me. It's a type of expression or something that comes off somebody's mouth when he's trying to take something out of his nails. Something gets stuck and he keeps trying, kisses his teeth. He says, oof, it's not coming out. From the smallest of things that can come out of a person's mouth. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, he never ever said this to me. وَلَا قَالَ لِي لِشَيْءٍ فَعَلْتُهُ لِمَ فَعَلْتَ كَذَا وَهَلَ فَعَلْتَ كَذَا. And he never ever said to me, when I done something, why did you do this or why did you not do this? My brothers and sisters, also Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us as a side benefit. Maybe the kids, they can take this as a lesson. وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. Do not say uff to your parents. Again, it's a very small type of example that is brought in order to show that one shouldn't even show the slightest of frustration to his parents. Let alone one shouting at his parents, talking back at them. You see, I remember, subhanAllah, just recently one of my aunties was telling me that her ex-husband, whenever he got into an argument, there was a time when normally he would always be shouting. Without, you know, that's just one thing that was normal in the house. One time he became angry and ended up hitting his mother. Today we hear it like it's normal. The parents being insulted, being shouted out, being sworn at. Also, it came in another hadith, Hadith Abdullah ibn Amr ibn Asir radiallahu ta'ala anhu. When the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ مَنْ سَبَّ وَالِدَيْهِ. The one who insulted his parents won't enter into Al-Jannah. So the companion, he asked, فَهَلْ يَسُبُّ الرَّجُلُ وَالِدَيْهِ. Is it even possible for a son or a child to come and insult his parents? It was ajeeb to them. It was strange to them. But this is now something that is prevalent, that is kadhalik. Not just sub, shouting, bossing them about, telling them what we should be doing and what should be happening. In another narration, Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, خَدَمْتُهُ فِي السَّفَرِ وَالْحَضَرِ. I accompanied the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when I resided with him and also when I was traveling with him. He was accompanying him all these times. وَلَا قَالَ لِي لِشَيْءٍ لَمْ أَصْنَعُهُ لِمَا لَمْ تَصْنَعْ هَذَا هَكَذَا. He never said to me in something that I didn't do properly, why didn't he do something in this proper way? وَكَانَ أَحْسَنَ النَّاسِ خُلُقًا. He was the best of them when it came to manners and etiquettes. What was so interesting about mentioning the etiquette of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on his travels? Because normally when a person's on his travels, you know, bad habits start coming out. He's outside his comfort zone. This is why they say if you want to give somebody your daughter, go on a travel with him. Go and travel with that person. His frustration tends to come out. And you begin to see, okay, what type of things frustrate this individual? Find some people's anger levels are different from others. Maybe the bus comes late, this guy's throwing in a tantrum. And it's kadali, there's people like that. You understand from that? What type of individual, his attitude? At a time when maybe you come towards a shop, مثلاً, or you want to buy some food. There's a type of person who's very generous and won't allow the other person to pay. And there's a type who's waiting for the other one to take out his money. He's stingy and he's holding his hands back. Things that you learn upon traveling. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they didn't have a bad thing to say about it. I will conclude with this inshaAllah ta'ala. Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, مَا سُئِلَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam شَيْئًا فَقَالَ لَا. Never was the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ever asked for something and he ever said no. Another narration, Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu, he says, مَا سُئِلَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ شَيْئًا إِلَّا أَعْطَاهُ. Never was the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked under the name of Islam for something and he always gave that individual. فَجَاءَهُ رَجُلٌ فَأَعْطَاهُ غَنَمًا بَيْنَ جَبَلَيْنِ. A man came to him and he gave him all the livestock that was placed in between two mountains. فَرَجَعَ إِلَى قَوْمِ. He went back to his people. فَقَالَ يَا قَوْمِ أَسْلِمُوا. O my people, embrace Islam. فَإِنَّ مُحَمَّدًا يُعْطِي الْعَطَاءَ مَنْ لَا يَخَافُ الْفَاقَةِ. For indeed the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Muhammad, he in fact said, gives in charity like an individual who doesn't fear any poverty. As a side benefit, something that Shaykh Abdul Razak al-Badr, حَفِظَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, he mentioned, when explaining this hadith in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's masjid 2 years ago, mentioned a very interesting story. How sometimes maybe exerting your efforts in guiding somebody who has influence in the community is something that a person might want to consider and take into reflection. There was this village where the people of the sunnah couldn't ever get into. It was a place where bid'ah innovation was so prevalent. Many du'at callers, they tried to go there, the door was slammed shut in their faces. So there was this da'i, this caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who was quite smart. And he had some money as well. He went to this village and he asked around, where is the sahib al-qabila? Or the head of the tribe. So he was told he lives in such and such place. He tried, or he specifically tried to go to his house just before the salah. Knocked on his door, He said, oh, mashallah, subhanallah, you know, I've heard so much great things about you. And I've decided today to gift you with some money because I heard you were in need. This is for you and your kids who may be suffering from some poverty at the time. So while they're walking to the masjid, it's time in the salah, right? Starts in, you know, engaging in conversation with him. And he requests from him to give a little speech after the salah. Like I mentioned before, it's a village where the people of the sunnah, they couldn't get anywhere near it. They tried their utmost best, and bid'ah and shirk is so prevalent. So they pray their prayer, the sunnah is prayed. The tribe leader, he gets up and grabs the mic. Oh, you don't know what's going to happen now. You probably think that, you know, he's going to say something negative. Gets up, takes the mic. My brothers and sisters, he praises him like no other. This individual, he came to me. He looked after me even though I was struggling and many people haven't helped me. And so on and so forth. Gave him such a long introduction. And then allowed him to give a kalima. The moral of the story. Tribe leader, he becomes guided. Everybody else becomes guided. You exert your efforts in trying to call him to the sunnah. It could be the reason why all of them accept the sunnah. I remember in London, there was a lot of gangs. The gang leader, who was a non-Muslim at that time, embraces Islam. You get another 20 following behind him. So the point is, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam would give and would give. He wouldn't say no. And the scholars who came after him, my brothers and sisters, took this from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and it's a great characteristic trait to have. Something that is deficient in a lot of us. Sometimes we tend to pose the question, why is this person only calling me or asking for my help when he needs something? And it's gadali, guys. And this is something that pops up into our minds all the time. But rather, my brothers and sisters, it's a virtue. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose you among so many people that could have participated in establishing this khair, fulfilling the needs of this individual. Look at Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala what he said about Shaykh al-Islam. He said, كَانَ شَيْخُ الْإِسْلَامِ بْنَ تَيْمِيَا يَسْعَى فِي حَوَائِجِ النَّاسِ سَعْيًا شَدِيدًا. He would help the people and strive his utmost best in a very earnest way, trying to fulfill the needs of the people. لِأَنَّهُ يَعْلَمْ, because he knows. كُلَّمَا عَانَ غَيْرَهُ أَعَانَهُ اللَّهُ. And every time he helped others, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would go out and help that individual. Look at the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One time a woman came to him and she said to him, إِنَّ لِي إِلَيْكَ حَاجَةً. I need you to help me. يَا أُمَّ فُلَانٍ أُنْدُرِي أَيِّ السِّكَكِ شِئْتِي. Oh, the mother of so-and-so, take me to wherever you need. حَتَّى أَقْضِيَ لَكِ حَاجَتِكِ, so I can fulfill your need for you. فَخَلَى مَعَهَا فِي بَعْضِ الطُّرُقِ حَتَّى فَرَغَتْ مِنْ حَاجَتِهَا. So she ended up taking the Messenger to different places until he ended up fulfilling her need. In another narration, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَحَبُّ النَّاسِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَنْفَعْهُمْ لِلنَّاسِ. The most beloved people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those who are most beneficial to the others. وَأَحَبُّ لِأَعْمَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ سُرُورٌ تُدْخِلُهُ عَلَى مُسْلِمٍ. And the most beloved actions to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is some happiness that you enter into your brother's heart. Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the most busiest of people, but still he had the time. Sometimes a trait that I really, you know, find it imperative to always warn about is when a person becomes maybe a scholar or a da'iyah or somebody who is very well respected in the community, becomes busy from his family, مثلا. Or he becomes busy from the community itself. Or he's not seen by the people, feeling that he's seen in the community to walk around, that his haybah, the respect that the people have for him, will drop. This is the trait of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There was nobody more busy than him.
Even the mushrikun, they would say, مَا لِهَذَا الرَّسُولِ يَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامَ وَيَمْشِي فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ. What's wrong with this messenger? He walks like everybody else in the markets. And he eats like everybody else as well. لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ فَيَكُونَ مَعْهُ نَذِيرًا. If only there was an angel sent with him, so that the angel can be a warner with him. No matter how qualified or how great our status has become in the society, nobody is more busy than the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the people are in need of you all the time. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to benefit us from what we heard and to make us from those who truly, truly love the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let's ask ourselves, my brothers and sisters, this question. If you take out the salawat out of our lives, how much do we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger? Salah is like the only interaction we have on a regular 24-hour basis, right? Because the fasting takes place once a year. The hajj takes place once in a lifetime. The zakah, if that person has that money and it reaches a certain amount, you take the salah out. How much of us, my brothers and sisters, are we going about with, you know, implementing the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We want to be with him. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءَ وَالصَّالِحِينَ. Those who follow Allah Azza wa Jalla's Messenger, they will be from with those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed His favors upon them. From the نبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين. The prophets, the truthful ones, the shuhada, the martyrs, and the righteous amongst them. And we can only do that, my brothers and sisters, if we really want to die saying that kalima, that la ilaha illallah, and upon the way of the Messenger, and to be brought on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Because the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us on Yawm al-Qiyamah, al-mar'u ma'a man ahab. The person, he will be with the person that he loves. If we love Cristiano Ronaldo, we will be with him on Yawm al-Qiyamah. We love Messi, we will come on Yawm al-Qiyamah, we're with him. We might mention Messi's name, or like a day-to-day Harry Kane, right? It was coming home. We were discussing this in the car today. Maybe nobody's going to attend. If the England game goes to penalties, I remember it happened this to one of the masajid. The England game was going on. I was doing a dawrah. The moment the England game started, the numbers dropped. Even the jama'ah starts being questioned as to whether we should go or not. Are we mentioning Rooney? Rooney's retired now, right? Harry Kane and all these other players, Messi, Ronaldo, Neymar, Mbappe, the new guy on the scene at the moment. Are these people's names more on our tongues than the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us from those who are followers of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in truth and who implement his sunnah laylan wa nahara, sabahan wa masaa. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك اللهم ات نفوسنا تقواها وزكها انت خير من زكاها انت وليها ومولاها said dua that the Sheikh Abdul Razak al-Badr, the teachers of the Haram, used to either start his lesson with or he would conclude it. Oh Allah, purify our hearts, and oh اللهم ات نفوس, oh Allah, gift our hearts with the taqwa, وزكها, and purify our hearts. You are his protector and you are his guardian. And may Allah Azza wa Jal do that for us. Jazakum Allah khair, my brothers and sisters, for listening attentively. And Jazakum Allah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.